holy
Pastor Dana coming to you again by way of YouTube Church. Oh, we've been talking about that this past week, and we're so glad to be able to reach you at home or at work or even while you're out on the road. We've heard people checking in with us in so many different ways on so many different devices, and we just praise God for the ability to be able to do this. This week, we're going to be looking at a couple of texts, one in Ezekiel and another one in the gospel that is appointed for us from St. Mark chapter 4, which will be what you need to be looking at if you got your Bibles open at home. But in both of those, we want to look at the whole idea of that old phrase, ignorance is bliss. I imagine you've said that in the past. We'll see how that deals with our relationship with God and His workings in our lives. So let us begin our time together this day with a simple prayer that most of us memorized in our younger years as we went through confirmation classes together. Blessed Lord, since You have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. In Jesus' name we all pray, amen. And so now to the scriptures. Our first reading comes to us from the prophet Ezekiel. And if you have your Bible there, I'll let you give you a couple seconds there. You'll find it's in the 17th chapter, Ezekiel chapter 17, and we'll start down at verse number 22. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar, and I will set it out. I will break off from the topmost of its young twigs a tender one, and I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel will I plant it, that it may bear branches and produce fruit and become a noble cedar. And under it will dwell every kind of bird. In the shade of its branches, birds of every sort will nest. And all the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree, and I make high the low tree. Dry up the green tree, and make the dry tree flourish. I am the Lord, I have spoken, and I will do it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, our gospel text, which we'll be reading this day and also meditating upon, is from St. Mark, as I said before, chapter 4, and you can scroll on down to verse 26. Jesus is speaking here to his disciples. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and he rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. And he said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? It's like a grain of mustard seed, which when sown on the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and it becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, my friends, when I was a young man, I was still in my short pants, probably 4 or 5 years old, I can remember my mother making fruit cocktail cakes. She did up until she was in her 90s. A fruit cocktail is absolutely moist, and it's just so succulent, all those little pieces, you know. I don't know where she got the recipe from, probably on the back of a can of Del Monte fruit cocktail. Who knows? I didn't care. I just liked to eat the stuff, and I ate larger quantities of it than probably I should have, as you can see, probably still do. Well, years later, and probably I was about, you know, 8, 9, 10 years old, I watched my mother actually put that cake together. And she did it. It did something that I really didn't like at all, because although she was following the recipe, she substituted sour cream for the milk. That's something I hated back then, and I'm still not wild about it, although my children and grandchildren stick sour cream or ranch dressing on everything they eat. Well, once the cake was finished baking in the oven, she took it out. She let it cool a little bit, and she gave us a piece of it, you know, and I dug into that piece, well, pretty cautiously, because I knew what was in it, sour cream. Well, of course, it tasted great, because she made it the same way she had always been making it. What I'm getting at is sometimes, you know, a thing is good just on its own without knowing all of the intricacies and movements within it, you know. And to know too much might ruin our satisfaction and appreciation of it. Ignorance, as they say, is bliss. Now, it's the same way with the seed that we find in Mark's gospel here. And you have to understand, Jesus is speaking. What is being scattered is the kingdom of God. You, me, all those who gather under the cross of Jesus Christ, it's being scattered with no distinction between the kinds of soil in which it's sown. In other words, it's to be sown in every place, automatically. In other words, growth happens, and it is good, but the man, he just doesn't know why. And the man, that's you and me, you know. All we know is that in time, an abundant harvest will come. There's a problem, though. We can't seem to get our noses out of God's business sometimes, you know? We want to make things happen ourselves, our way, our time, you know? When it comes to the kingdom of God in particular, we want to be able to explain growth or decline in it, especially in these post-COVID days. And certainly we want someone to show us the steps to how to make it grow. And we want to show people the steps that, well, took place when we experienced growth. We all have someone. We all have someone that we care for who seems to be outside the kingdom of God, disconnected from the faith. And we want to know what we can do, or that our church can do, or the pastor can do, to turn them around so that they can find hope and joy in Jesus Christ. This past week, I spent 3 days down in San Marcos, Texas, at the 67th Convention of the Texas District of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. At first, I thought not many people would show up, and then when I got there, I found out the place was packed out. And I looked around the room, and I saw something that I hadn't seen. In all my years of ministry, I saw people that weren't not blanched out of skin any longer. They weren't a bunch of old immigrant German families, you know. All of a sudden, I realized that the biggest growth that was taking place in our beloved district was within the Hispanic communities and within the Black communities of the inner cities of our largest metropolitan areas, and also in that Rio Grande Valley. I had the opportunity to see an older, he was probably in his upper 60s, maybe 70s, a Hispanic man with Bible in hand, couldn't speak a lick of English, but the translator sat there, shared his story, what was going on, as he had come to have his faith regenerated within the ranks of a missionary who talked to him one-on-one. He got his friends, his family, he just went and asked him to come and see, you know. And they did, and they heard about this Jesus and the forgiveness and mercy, and that it wasn't about our works, but the works of Jesus, and that freedom from just the self-imposed guilt that I'm never good enough, I'm never going to get to heaven. They shared the joy of finding out their assurance is in Jesus Christ. And so he gathered together 100 people, and out of that 100 people, he invited 25 of them there just to go out to another place in the city and find others to share this message with. And they did, and it grew, and they peeled off another 25, and this went on 7 times. Natural, organic, lots of terms used for it, but simply sharing the gospel and letting God do His stuff through it. But the truth behind people developing and strengthening their relationships with Jesus, it's always been this way. It's not in new things that we can do in the present, but focusing our attention basically on what Jesus did in the past, is doing in the present by redeeming people today, and will do in the future, because he says this will be going on till the day he returns. In other words, we're not to assume that something is missing in the gospel. The power of the gospel is salvation. It's not in things that we supply, add to or take away from it, or improve on it. I mean, God's process of saving people is beyond our comprehension, and it's accomplished in ways that are far different than any of us would conjure up. The growth of God's kingdom is up to Him, not us. And Jesus highlights that in the parable. The kingdom of God is if a man should scatter the seed on the ground, okay? Just scatter it. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. It's all done in a way beyond our comprehension. My friends, Christ's death on the cross of Calvary has redeemed the entire world. Jesus said that it is finished. And the kingdom of God is already sown everywhere that the gospel is being preached. In you and me, it's in the people of God, in the church, you know, in your unbelieving loved ones. I mean, even in that atheist neighbor next door, you know. It's when the Holy Spirit empowers them to believe it that salvation is wrought, as the old King James would put it. The only growth that's going to happen is going to occur by God's design. Not by our efforts, not by your effort, not by you pressuring them or badgering them to get to church or whatever, you know. It's God who grants the growth automatically. The word in the text there, by itself, is automate, automatically. Now, perhaps it's not, you know, all at the same time or in the same way for every person, because you and I are different people. And you and I, we bump into different people. And so God uses our unique abilities to share the gospel and their unique abilities to hear it in a fashion that we can't understand. Theologians throughout the centuries have always asked, you know, proclaiming the gospel to every people, well, then why some and not others? Can't answer that question. God does what he does when he wants to do it and how he wants to do it. But he does assure us that his kingdom is there, whether people recognize it or not. If it were up to us to accomplish faith in our own hearts or church growth at large, you know, you would think that after 2,000 years, we'd have figured that out, don't you think? You know, growth would be just happening in leaps and bounds. Only God can bring about the perfect kingdom that we're all seeking, which may very well be comprised of superstar Christians, lovable couch Christians, all together. Growth happens in God's time, in God's way, and we know not how, because if we did, we would probably stress out because we haven't been doing a very good job of it. And our Lord is more interested in freeing our guilty conscience in his forgiving grace and granting us his holy and eternal joy that it'll be well done because he'll be doing it. Yet, I know, we just can't let go. It's just the way we are, our self-esteem, you know, our need to have some way of being the center of attention. We just don't let it go. What can we do then? What do we do about declining churches? And what do we do about our seemingly lost loved ones? How do we increase our faith to withstand the temptation to just give in to the popular opinion? The answer: the man sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows, he knows not how. Like the man, we go about our day-to-day responsibility as a child of God in our God-given vocations. Love and mercy that we receive from God is love and mercy that we give to others. Starting at our homes, you know, maybe overflowing at our schools, our workplaces, even within community gatherings. Jesus says the seed of God's kingdom grows automatically. We scatter seed, just like Johnny Appleseed in that children's novel. We just scatter it and we go on. It isn't always quick. Sometimes God takes his time. We cannot rush it along. We are called simply to go about our vocations night and day and see how God provides the growth to the seeds that we sow. And the seeds are nothing more than the gospel of Jesus Christ and the hope that lives within our hearts. We're going to be tempted along the way to try to help things along with our own ideas and by our own effort and strength. There's thousands of books on how to build your church and how to do this and how to do that. But just as you can't force a flower to grow, or don't always know exactly when into that fruit cocktail cake, in time, the kingdom's beauty and goodness will be revealed and will be far more joyous than we ever could imagine. The way I see it is when I get up to heaven, I suspect St. Peter might be a little bit snarky to me, because that's one of my character traits. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's funny, sometimes it's just not. But I would tend to think that, you know, it would be poetic justice to find out that the things that I thought I did to help build the kingdom actually hurt. That would be kind of, you know. Or the things that I used to say others did to hurt the growth in the kingdom turned out to be the good things. You never know. You never know. So rather than stress out, we are appealed to by the Holy Spirit to just know, to trust, to believe that when it comes to kingdom growth and even our own personal faith development, God will grant the growth in his time and his way through his word, strengthened by his sacrament. So for now, we are encouraged to live out our vocations and in patience as a child of God, praying for the growth that he has promised will come through that gospel and through the sacraments in our time and in our place. We just continue to do what Christians have done for the last 2,000 years. On a more personal note, you may be asking, how are you going to make it? You've lost your spouse, your loved one. Maybe you've gone through a divorce. Maybe you're retired. Maybe you're unemployed. Maybe your health or the health of a close loved one is failing. Maybe your children have forsaken the faith. Maybe your dreams and aspirations in life are now out of reach. The man sleeps, and he rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows, he knows not how. God will give you the strength to weather whatever storm there is in your life. Trust, believe in Jesus. Rather than stress out, my friends, know that when it comes to kingdom growth, whether it be at church at large or whether it just be in your walk with the Lord, ignorance is bliss. Just trust the Lord. For by the gospel of Jesus' death and resurrection, God will grant you growth in His time and in His way. He will mold you by His gospel. He will strengthen you by His sacraments. He will make you to be the child that He wants you to be fully human, even as Adam and Eve were at the beginning. That's His task. That's the hope that you have and the assurance of eternal life with Him. Share this with those you encounter in your life, and then kick back and watch God do His stuff. And all God's people said, Amen. And so now, my friends, we pray. Almighty, merciful God, we have again worshiped in Your presence and received both the forgiveness for our many sins and assurance of Your love in Jesus. We thank You for this undeserved grace, and we ask that You keep us in faith until with all Your saints we inherit eternal salvation. In Jesus' most precious name we pray, Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. Amen. Until next week, God's blessings.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, You rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. Always hungry.